this orientation program. My name is Smita Polite and I work with the university as its communicator. The university-wide orientation program is designed to help the incoming students get acquainted with the university community and understand the mission and vision of the university. This will be supplemented by school-level orientation programs. This is a week of opening up, getting to know each other, a week of sharing, and a week of celebrating all that Nalanda stands for. The initial few people and the initial few years are the ones that will give shape to Nalanda's vision. We have come together, and that is a beginning. But as a popular saying goes, coming together is a beginning, keeping together is progress, and working together is success. Thus, I will urge the incoming class of 2015-17 and the Nalanda pioneers to be fully involved and work together with all of us to make the orientation week and indeed the university a grand success. So without further ado, I would like to now request the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Gopa Sabharwal, to deliver the welcome speech and declare the new academic year open.
As you can see, everyone here themselves, you will learn, you will make connections with other individuals who come from diverse backgrounds. You will go beyond the confines of your disciplinary boundaries and also maybe feel uncomfortable about re-examining a lot of your established beliefs. So I hope, all told, your time at Nalanda is a time that in a way shakes you up in very fundamental ways, but also helps you grow as human beings. Before we go further, and as Smita said, this is the first time that we're all meeting together for the new academic year. I'd also like to extend a welcome back to all of our faculty who have come back from the summer. We have a couple of new members of the faculty. So for them, it is their first exposure to Nalanda. So in many ways, like you, they're also starting out afresh now. I would want to tell our students at this point that you must never forget that all of our faculty, and I know I'm saying this on behalf of our faculty, are here for you at all times. They're here to help you, to guide you, and also to encourage you to question and debate and argue with them. They are here to help you push your boundaries of your knowledge, but also for you to question some of their assumptions. And at all times, they're there, and I'm sure they will tell you more about this in the days to come. But I know that I can commit that on behalf of all of our faculty. Also present in the auditorium are our senior administration and all members of the Nalanda University staff. This is a collection of very hardworking people, some of whom you have met in the last few days because they were helping you settle in. All of that section of people have been here through the summer, trying to make the university a still better place to be at. You may not have seen all of them, you may not continue to see all of them all the time, but I can assure you that all of them are working at various dimensions of making this university the place it is, and are here to look after your needs, to help you settle in comfortably. There are some new members in that team too, and I think this is an orientation for them too. So I would like to welcome all of them to the Nalanda family and also give you a chance to see some of them. So, and on behalf of this very talented group of administration and staff, I would again like to say that there is nothing more important for them than to ensure the safety, the security, and the comfort of our students and their experience at Nalanda. So you need to know that everybody here is, to a very large extent, working to make your time at Nalanda the best time that we can give you. The other set of people I forgot to mention are, of course, our returning students. Some of them we know are away on fieldwork. But that is the one group of people who will play a big role in helping you settle in. So I hope they're concentrating and listening on that And we look forward for them to guide you, to help you, and show you the ropes. Of our senior administrative team, they are on the stage. Our Dean Academic Planning, Dr. Anjana Sharma, is responsible for all of our academic programs and initiatives and our partnerships and the development of our schools and the new school that is going to come in next year. We have as our registrar Professor Nehal, who's coming from the Central University of Bihar with a lot of experience of universities. And as our finance officer is Mr. Chandramurthy, who's coming from the University of Pondicherry after a very long distinguished career. These are the people you will, who head various divisions of our administration. The rest of their teams, when you come to the office tomorrow and we show you around, we will try and they will try and introduce you to them. So on a more formal level, orientations are like a modern day ritual. And I think they're important to have these modern day rituals. It's important for communities to come together periodically to think about what it is they're doing, to remind ourselves of why we're here. So it's as much for you as it is for the rest of us to stop and think once in a while as to why we have come together to do this orientation. From your point of view, of course, you may be very bewildered by a lot of what is happening around you. I'm hoping that you will settle down as the week goes by. I think you all know what the orientation program is. 2 days of university orientation, followed by an orientation by each of the schools, where you will have enough time to meet and interact with your faculty and for them to tell you about the visions of the school, what they expect from you, and how the programs will work. From my point of view, what is it that I've been thinking, I must admit only from this morning because I've had no time, that what it is that I would want to say to an incoming batch of students about Nalanda University. Of course, the first thing that I would do is to tell you that this is not just any ordinary university that you have chosen to be a part of. This is Nalanda University. And it is a university that has been established to follow in the legacy of a precursor that stands alone with regards to its internationalism, its ability to generate and transmit ideas, and its longevity amongst many of the other things that Old Nalanda stood out for. Old Nalanda, however, is not great only because it lasted 800 years, though that in itself is also an achievement. Because if you know, I don't know how many of you know the history of universities, the oldest Indian universities that you see right now were only established in 1857. So they are, I think, about 158 years old, if my math is correct. And in these 158 years of existence, we are today talking again and again about the university being in crisis, about questioning what the university is doing. Given that scenario, for an institution to have existed for a continuous 800 unbroken years is a remarkable achievement that the original establishment was able to fulfill. We also know that Old Nalanda was great because it was offering an education at that time of a kind that we take for granted in today's world. It was doing that at a time when it had no other similar institutions, though of course we know in Bihar it did have some other centers which helped to, with which it was in a sense in competition, if I may use the word in a particular way, which were urging it to continue to strive to be the kind of university it was. It was offering education, advanced education, on a variety of subjects. And as a matter of fact, for those of you who like these kind of facts, it was the only institution of learning outside China to which any ancient Chinese ever went for higher education. That was the kind of standing of the institution. For those of you who have not seen the ruins of the old university, we're very fortunate that not only will you be visiting the university ruins tomorrow, you will be doing so in the company and in the guidance of two of our very talented historians, both of whom are experts on the region and on the heritage of the region, and I do not think you could have a better guide for your first introduction and exposure to Nalanda ruins than these two people. So I'm not sure how many of you have actually been to Old Nalanda. Okay, so for most of you it's going to be a first. And I can assure you, with these people as your guides, it will be a special process. Coming back to the question that I raised, what is it that we are going to do? What is it that I could tell you about Old Nalanda? One of the first things that I would, that did come to my mind was that you must be, the process of building a university and re-establishing a university cannot be the outcome of one person's thoughts or work. It is a collaborative effort. And in that collaborative effort, one group of people who are not here today, but who have been largely responsible for giving shape, form, and structure to the idea, to the vision, and to what we are trying to do, is our governing board. They've been at the forefront of this endeavor since 2006. You are going to, a little later on, get to hear and see some of them speak to tell you about what it is that is their vision. And I think one of the reasons we're also sharing that with you is because we want you to know that just as all of us, faculty, administration, staff, are engaged in the process of giving shape to this new university, we expect you also to become partners in that process and to take on that responsibility. You are as much part of shaping the destiny of New Nalanda as any of us are. And I think if there is one message that I would want to give to you today, that would be one of those, one main message, is that you must all remember you are the early batch of students who have come in to shape this university. And at all times, we would like you to remember that and to help to come up with ideas, to engage in the process, to think about what it is that we are doing. Having said that, I think the only thing that I could think of to do is to put in perspective for you where in the history of universities do we now stand? At which point do we stand now? And so that you can understand a little bit of what it is that I'm asking you to think about where we will go in the future. So coming back to that story, I don't know if you're aware, but in the 800 years between the destruction of Old Nalanda and the current project to establish New Nalanda, the nature and form of the university as an institution underwent a complete transformation. The University of Nalanda, when it came to an end, if you look at the general landscape of university establishments at that point, only the University of Oxford and Paris had been founded. They had just been founded. Cambridge was yet to be founded. Bologna, the first university in the Western world, had been founded earlier. It came into existence when Nalanda was 600 years old. And Al-Azhar in Cairo had come into being when Nalanda was 500 years old. There was, at the time of destruction of Nalanda, not a single university in the United States of America. All of the new universities, the explosion in the establishment of universities, happened in this period of 800 years between the destruction and decline of Old Nalanda and the period where we now stand. Not only was there a decline in universities, what has happened in this intermediate period is that the Western model of the university has come very largely to dominate what education must stand for. And I do not think we need to debunk that, because I think where we are, that has become the tried and tested model of the university. But there are, even in that story, certain fundamental debates and certain fundamental decisions that were taken. The first, of course, came in after all of the old universities were essentially religious establishments. You could only, to a large extent, your entry into those establishments was dependent on your status at birth, your standing in society, and of course, you know, so it was not an automatic kind of by right admission that you could have. I think the biggest change that happened in that scenario was in the 18th century, when, and this change happened differently in France and in Germany. In France, what happened was the French started to focus more on training people for particular employment. So they thought the university's purpose is to train people for employment, as opposed to the German university, essentially epitomized by the University of Berlin, which began to talk about the unity of teaching and research. So while the French idea linked university education to careers and subsequently employment, the good thing is that both these changes did away with patronage and birth as the sole determinants of university education. But the German model of research and teaching ensured that universities were no longer only transmitting knowledge or existing knowledge, but that universities were going to become the place for the creation of new knowledge. And that is the idea that went to the United States. We know that the universities of Johns Hopkins and then Chicago became the first research universities to follow that kind of idea, and to a position where we are now, where specialization to some extent has become the hallmark of at least the North American university. Of course, in the middle, there have been a few other changes post the World War, especially in the United States. They saw what was called the rise of the mass university, because suddenly they had to open up the university system to large amounts of people who were returning, and they needed to find spaces for them to go to. So the big changes in the world, of course, between then and now, is that the universities have got freedom from, let's say, religious control and regulation. They are now open to both genders, to all classes, all communities. They are open and they are secular institutions. And of course, the universities are the precursors of becoming less conservative organizations. Universities were no longer the protectors of a certain kind of traditional value. Universities became the places where new ideas came in. Over the last, and especially I think in the last two decades or more, we've also seen the explosion, because of the rise of the research university, you're seeing the emergence of new branches of science and scholarship. To an extent now, that no single university can today claim to do as its precursors did, to have a department for every single kind of branch of knowledge that is known to the academy. Universities are having to pick and choose which disciplines they will follow. We've also seen the rise of the specialist university that only now specializes in one or two disciplines. Given all of this idea, I think the one thing that has happened, and that's the one that I'm going to leave you, I'm going to stop in exactly 2 minutes. The idea that I want you to think about, and this is a debate that we could hopefully engage in as the year progresses, is as a university and as we stand at this juncture, are we going to go with the idea of specialization and only look at specialization in a narrow sense of acquiring a particular kind of knowledge, quite divorced from a wider human reality? Or are we going to manage to keep track of some of what the original purpose of the university was, which was to train citizens and hopefully also leaders? And I think which model Nalanda University will follow ultimately will depend on how everybody in this room decides to think about and construct their schools, their curriculum, their responses to that curriculum, Because at this moment, I think where we are is we would want you all, and which is why, I mean, I think a lot of you read that when you came in, we have taken a very conscious decision to look at interdisciplinarity of knowledge. We are trying to encourage ourselves and you to move beyond these labels of specialization and super specialization and to look at the world as a united whole and to try and think sometimes about what it is that you are going to do that in a way could impact the world and could be something that is out of your realm of, you know, your niche area of specialization. And I think, so I let you know where in the debate I stand, and I think most of the people on the faculty benches, and I'm sure Anjana, are on that side of the debate, right, on that side of the divide. But this is something that I would like you to think about. And I would also encourage you and urge you not only to follow interdisciplinarity within your schools, but to feel free to walk into a course being taught by somebody, even if it is not for marks, but because it interests you, and to widen your horizons while you're here. Okay? So have a good time, and I'll see more of you as the year progresses.
Thank you so much. I would now request the Dean Academic Planning, Dr. Anjana Sharma, to deliver the orientation speech.
You know, I'll just stand here in front of you, so many thoughts are coming to me. I have something written down because, well, I just thought I should write something. Now, whether I'm going to share it or not is another matter. Because as I was hearing the Vice Chancellor speak and I was watching your faces, all kinds of things were happening inside of me. I think I was looking smilingly impassive in terms of my physical self. But firstly, for me, it's such a huge triumph that we are actually in this room. And there's so many of you. Last year, I think there were 3 faculty members, or maybe 5, who were with us. And we did this very same orientation where, within this complex in a small room. And because we were so small, parents were present. So, you know, families were present. And it was a very, I recall the mood of that ceremony, because that's what it was. I think all of us were very emotional that day. I think both the new students, their families who had accompanied them, the small, very small team at the university, many of the people you've seen in the room today were not with us. And of course we were hysterical with worry because we were trying to do everything on our own. This is a university in which the Vice Chancellor will work harder than anybody. Will be also seen and heard, as you will discover, as time passes by. So things happen in a different way. And I was just sitting here and saying, we've already begun to grow. And you know, soon this room will fill up. And thankfully, because of the present Chief Minister, who was the former Chief Minister, there is a bunch of people that I have seen, all of you. Whether it's the staff, whether it's the Nalanda Pioneer students, whether it's the founding faculty, whether it's all of you students. Some of you have met across Skype and tried to encourage smilingly as you have looked nervous and said why you would like to come. I haven't this year interviewed every single student. Last year I interviewed every single student. But I will get to know you over time. Why do I think you're brave? Because many of the things the Vice Chancellor was speaking about the fact that we're in the 21st century, and the lessons of the 20th century have been pretty harsh. And we're still trying to deal with the lessons of the 20th century. Yes, huge advances. Your generation, even my generation, cannot imagine now a life without a cell phone. But there was a life without a cell phone. Possibly it was better in some ways. But we are the mobile generation in every which way. But the 21st century, of course, it's modern scientific advances, technological advances, so many other advances, with one giant leap backwards, which is conflict, conflict, and more conflict. Division, division, and more division. So I think in the 21st century, one of the things we have to decide in this room amongst ourselves is, in this room are present all the people who will write the script of the 21st century. Yes or no?
Yes.
I don't hear it.
Yes.
We will write the script again. Don't think of yourself as somebody who's come to teach at Nalanda, to earn a living at Nalanda, to study at Nalanda, to get a degree from Nalanda, all of which you will hopefully get in good time. But you've come here because you have a mission. I firmly believe that all of us, and we come from diverse backgrounds, we come from many different parts of the world, we come from different cultural, linguistic, religious, social, ethnic backgrounds. In fact, there are many people who are not being able to be present today because we were doing interviews till I think yesterday or day before, because our international admissions were kind of following after the national group. So we are going to have students. We already have certain international students in our first batch, but you're also going to get students from Laos, from Myanmar, from Cambodia, from Bhutan, and certain other countries who are going to be joining you. So I was trying to think to myself, what is it that makes people look at us? We're still not there, you know? What is it that was the reason that so many of you must have seen the ad, must have heard from somebody, and you decided to make that application, and you persisted in your application because you completed your application. Many of the applications were not complete, so we just never bothered to speak to those people who had not even made the effort of completing their applications. Members of the faculty have also come from diverse places, diverse time zones, from different backgrounds and experiences. But we are all here today. And I think the only reason we have here today is because the future of the world lies in Rajgir. It used to lie at one time in Rajgir. It lies here again. So the term you hear very, very often, and poor Smita must be very worried because first the Vice Chancellor always speaks her script and now the Dean is following suit in the spirit of friendly competition. So, you know, what is it that we are trying to do here? So there's a term which we hear a lot in the last 15, 20 years, particularly in the last decade, maybe more so in the last 5 years. And the term is Asian Renaissance. You know, it's a term we hear a lot, the revival of Asia. Asian tiger, etc., etc., you know, roaring again. And a huge competition between China and India, who will be tiger number one, etc. But I think the point that we are looking at is Asian Renaissance, for me, is a bit problematic, the way it is described in the public domain, because it's all about the economic, that monetizing of human relationships. It's not at all about person to person, heart to heart, thought to thought. So I think the opportunity that we have at Nalanda is to look at Asian Renaissance and to develop it differently. What does Asian Renaissance mean at Nalanda? Very simply, in a quick answer, because students like quick answers. Ma'am, tell me what to write down, so I'm ready for the exam. So the quick answer is, Asian Renaissance at Nalanda means that we will become the spirit that will once again begin to unite people. That of course begins with the hardest task that lies in front of all of us, which is to get along with each other. That's a pretty big challenge, to get along on a daily basis with each other, because we challenge each other not to get along with each other. So that is a big challenge, but if we overcome that and we try to see the world through the eyes of the other, and we do dialogue in the true Buddhist way, and dialogue in the Buddhist way is to listen, is to speak, and then to listen. Dialogue, as we understand, is I speak some more, you better be silent or I will say something else. So the Nalanda dialogue is based, predicated on hearing. So it's very, very important for all of us to become people who listen. Because good ideas, success in life, everything that you possibly wanted, you know, all the wonderful things that are awaiting you or have come to you already, they will only come if at Nalanda you hone your capacity to listen. Because Nalanda was about dialogue. It was about debate. It was about discussion. But all of these things, or none of these things, were about forcing your own view of the world upon somebody else. So, if I may make a small correction, Vaishnavasla, Nalanda is not only secular, and it is not only open to both genders, it is open to all genders. I'd like to share with you that when we were doing the admissions last year, just then the Supreme Court of India, which has made some regressive rulings, made a very advanced ruling for India, which is that transgenders are the third gender. And it was at that time the ruling came, and I went back to the Vice Chancellor and I said, the Nalanda form will indicate that we have the transgender on the form. So even though we have not been published in any newspaper as being the first people to do it, others followed, let me tell you, the Nalanda thinking is always in advance of other people's thinking. So you cannot have a spirit of accommodation, and you cannot have a respect for all people if you discriminate. Now, if you were to ask me, I would say I don't discriminate. But in the quietness of my heart, maybe in the darkness of the night or the early morning hour, I will accept to myself that I discriminate. So it's a constant struggle not to discriminate. So the Asian Renaissance that will flow out of Nalanda would be the ability to not prejudge, to not value our own views of the world above and over other ones. Now my faculty is in danger of going out to sleep, so I will carry forward. So what I really like to say is that, you know, Nalanda is not a geographical space. It's an idea. And that idea is bigger and larger and deeper and more profound than any one of us. So we may be in Rajgir, and Rajgir will bring with it, trust me, and I'm sure the pioneers and your faculty will tell you, its own challenges. But we are also aware of the fact that we are not just in this geographical entity which is called Rajgir. We are in that space which was crafted before, which we are fortunate enough to have a lucky star yoke to. Rajgir, Nalanda, Bihar, India. Big ideas. And all of you, and I know that many lectures have been given to you, you will have a good time. You're not only meant to be very serious over here and make profound statements every morning. Please indulge in great amount of levity. I'm a great believer in laughter. Okay? I laugh a lot. Sometimes at the wrong moments. But I do laugh a lot. So I would encourage you to wear more smiles and not look so grim. Because if you smile, the other person is initially suspicious, why is this person smiling at me? But after some time, after a few days, they think, maybe this person genuinely means to smile at me, so first you will see a tremulous smile and then the smile will come. So I think we have to become people, when we talk about these big terms, you know, we say civilization and dialogue. Civilization, dialogue, nice term. We even did a book for Nalanda with that title. So Abhishek is laughing. But what does civilization and dialogue mean? It means just generally having a polite conversation with the person next to you. If you can have a polite conversation with the person next to you, you're doing civilization, dialogue. So, of course we know that Nalanda's history is stellar, and that scholars came from all over the world at the time. You know, if you think traveling to Rajgir yesterday, today, day before has been difficult, think of Xuanzang. Think of how long Xuanzang took to come to Nalanda, and your own travels to Rajgir will be in perspective. Which is, it is no trouble at all to come to Rajgir. Okay? So, if you read the account of Xuanzang's travels, it is stunning. And the only thing that I could think about when I was reading is, what must he have expected to get out of Nalanda to have continued to come? He could have stopped anywhere. He had so many disasters on the way. It reads like a, you know, Victorian cliffhanger. This happened and then that happened. But the point is, not only did he come, he immersed himself in the spirit of Nananda. And it's a very little story which I'm going to tell, and then I'll tell you another quick story and then I'll go. So the one story that I want to tell you is that he came here, he was hugely successful, obviously. You know, there is a monument that the Chinese have built to him, which is in the region, very close by, where he's, I think, 7 feet 5 inches tall, because, well, some people are literal. And so the literal imagination of the Chinese who have built that wonderful monument, which tells his entire journey, he seems to be massive physically. But that's not the point. I'm a little person myself. So size for me has never mattered. Okay, but the important thing that we are talking about here is, he came, he immersed himself in the spirit of Nananda, he did exceedingly well, he was asked to stay back. In fact, he was coaxed, you stay back and you can become the new Vice Chancellor of Nananda University, he was told. This was in the past. So, he said that, no, I will go back. And there was just this consternation, why would you go back from the center of the world? Because at that time, Nananda was the center of the world. Why would you want to go from Nananda to anywhere else? And he said, because I had to take Nananda to my people. And this is what I hope each one of you will do. You will take back Nananda, not to your people, but to all people. Every conversation you have, you'll be taking back Nananda. Every time you post something on Facebook, you're taking back Nananda. Every time you blog something, you're taking back Nananda. So exercise care, because future generations are dependent upon how you will represent Nananda. So exercise care, because you are now historically responsible for Nananda. And that is a responsibility which you should not take lightly. Don't have to take it heavily, but also don't take it lightly. Now another little story, I've not said, read a word, I wrote such nice words, but I've not read one of it. One little story, which I think is the spirit of Nananda, the spirit of the faculty of Nananda, the spirit of all of us at Nananda. So on this coast, in an unnamed country, there were lots of people on a beach having a really good time. And there was this man walking, and he was ostensibly not having a very good time, in the sense he was not quaffing beer or, you know, generally tanning himself or having a good time. What he was doing was very simple. As he kept walking, you know, starfish were being thrown up from the ocean onto the beach. And what he was doing was that he was picking up as many starfish as he could, and he kept throwing them back into the ocean. You know, people were watching him, and then one person took pity on him and came to him and said, you know, this is a completely mindless activity. This is a zero-sum game. You know, you will not succeed at all. I mean, what is the point of throwing back starfish into the ocean? Because they have come onto the beach to die. The story has made the Dean of Historical Studies choke up. He knows the ending. Okay? So you say, what is the point? It makes no difference to the starfish when, you know, you're picking up on starfish and flinging it back into the ocean. And you do it day in and day out. And he gave one very simple answer, which I think is the spirit of Nananda. It makes a lot of difference to that starfish. So what you're going to get at Nananda is, you are those starfish. You will be constantly thrown into the ocean of ideas, into the ocean of debates, into the sea of conversations and great fun. And welcome to Nananda. Thank you so much for coming.
He inspired us, I'm sure everyone present in this room is. Thank you, that was beautiful. And as we move on, I will request everyone at the dais to
Yes,
we present
clearer.
Yeah. So thank you so much, and we are moving on to another section where we need to clear the stage.
As you can see, there are 1 billion people at the table of the audience. Okay.
Re-establishing Nalanda University has come from many Asian countries who value the connection with Nalanda and the whole Buddhist culture in India. And these countries of East Asia are very attached both to the site of Nalanda, to Rajgir, to Gaya, and so on. So there was a desire, and India promised at the East Asia Summit that Nalanda would be revived. And in 2007, a mentor group was set up by the then foreign minister, currently the Rashtrapati of the country, Mr. Pranab Mukherjee. And Professor Ramachandra Sen was appointed as the chairman of the mentor group.
My involvement was to propose it as an international university, because it was an international university. And if you can recreate it as an international university, then it can do some of the good which your own university did. And it arose out of a conversation I had with Wantek Singh Ahluwalia, vice chairman of the Denny Commission. I think it was in 2006 or 2007. And he asked me to write him a paper, which I did happily. And the Prime Minister, Manmohan Singh, agreed to establish a mentors group because Amartya, the chair.
I listened to Nalanda University, got to listen to the old Nalanda University was to offer excellent education, the best at that time and best now in the world, and do it without any kind of restriction of geography or other divisions like religion, nationality and so on. And I think it is very important to understand the commitment of Old Nalanda University for the highest quality education in the world, along with accepting ideas, good ideas, ideas that win arguments, no matter where they come from. That's what made Nalanda great, and that's what we want the present Nalanda to be great about.
Creating that spirit of men living in harmony with men living in harmony with nature, men living as part of nature, which was the old conception of Nalanda, that's not easy. But if you can achieve even a part of it, we would have created something which would help make this a better world for the 21st century. Taking over as the Chancellor from Amartya Sen, I think his shoes are impossible to fill. I mean, he has academic credentials, he has international network, which I cannot even hope to match. But I've been in politics for many years, so I will do what I can in the field which I'm good at, but continue to rely on Amartya Sen, who remains on the board, but who promised me that he'll continue to be involved.
We decided on the framework of the university to start with 7 schools. We realized that not all schools can come on board at the same time. So we wanted to introduce them in a phased manner. The first 2 schools that we decided to implement was the School of Environment and Ecology, and the second one was on Historical Studies. So these schools have now started. They have completed the first year. We have a number of students from different parts of Asia. And their faculty from different parts of the world. The next school that we want to introduce is a school on Buddhist studies and practical religious and philosophy. That I think has to do with Nalanda itself being an important institution that imparted knowledge of Buddhism. So that is the third school we want to establish perhaps in 2016, and that requires various kinds of infrastructure as well. So we hope that we'll have that ready by 2016. The other school said that we are planning is language and literature, that perhaps in 2017 again was a wonderful famous man. The other school that we wanted to have was economic and management school. That was again to relate to the contemporary need of education in Bihar and in South Asia as well. We also have plans for international relations and peace studies. That is something we hope to organize and implement. We'll have from the Japanese who are very interested in the peace studies aspect of it. And finally, the seventh school is information science and technology, because IT is very important not only for South Asia, but the whole world to get connected. So that's another school that we want to introduce in the first manner. But these are seven schools where we may at some point look at other schools that we can introduce. This is a postgraduate university, so we expect students to come with some knowledge and then we get to know that as they take any of these subjects.
We plan for at least seven schools, all of them interdisciplinary. We did not want to follow the model of disciplines as they have been defined in Western universities since about 1870. And then we took a strategic decision to start a university with two schools, the School of Historical Studies and the School of Ecology and Environmental Studies. I'm a historian myself, and I think that there is a great opportunity at Nalanda to build a very distinctive, almost unique School of Historical Studies. One that will focus on inter-Asian connections of all kinds. Asia is having an economic revival now. Asia went into decline in the context of the global economy from about the 1810s. But in the 2010s, the scenario has changed dramatically. And we have to study the flows of capital and labor, skills and services, ideas and cultures, which connected to different parts of Asia. So there is a great scope for comparative and connective Asian history to become the feature of the School of Historical Studies. Also, historians have moved beyond the nation, and there is a new trend in terms of writing global histories. So that is also something that we can pursue at the cutting edge. But in the School of Ecology and Environmental Studies, we are going to be addressing a major contemporary challenge. The environmental challenge is perhaps the most serious global challenge that we face today. But this school enables us to cross the boundary between the humanities and the sciences as well. So there are many scientific dimensions of how we plan to protect our environment. But it is a matter which also relates to even Buddhist philosophy. How do we create just the right balance between nature and human beings? Human beings have of late been launching an assault on nature. We need to learn how to live with nature.
These ideas, as you know, fall in three dimensions. First, there are many of these things which are intergovernmental, and I think it is a fostering the cooperation of many countries within the Asian regions. So this was an initiative of the East Asia Summit, where India had been also involved. And these countries are cooperating and collaborating, but the old Nalanda went far beyond Asia. The old Nalanda footprints, the old Nalanda was all over the world. So the second dimension is to look beyond Asian countries in building relationship with them. Many countries have shown strong interest. And then the third dimension, of course, is going beyond government with academic institutions, the centers of excellence elsewhere in the world, the Yale University, for instance, with universities in Australia, with the Peking University, with the Japanese University.
We have got a number of collaborations going as a result of this project. In fact, a number of countries have themselves come forward to offer financial contributions.
but also now we are looking at enhancing the scholarships from India for specific countries. So we already instituted these for the CMLB countries, which are four in number, plus we have also initiated it for Bhutan. In future, this will be extended also to countries like Nepal, Bangladesh, and Myanmar, etc., which would then form a nucleus of neighboring countries which would be able to contribute a lot of students in the future. And that's what we want to do, because to create Nalanda as a center of excellence in the neighborhood first, and after that to increase this influence and name in the outside world. So even some European countries like Portugal, for instance, are interested in signing an MOU and have signed an MOU with Nalanda University, with the government of Nalanda University. And in terms of collaboration with the university is seeking, I think we will put all our weight behind to see that it becomes a network of universities to benefit Nalanda in the end.
Many countries have already made generous endowments in the world. It's supposed to be a country of products and endowments. Australian government has made an important contribution in sharing resources. Chinese have made contributions have begun to come in from governmental and non-governmental entities. But this is really the tip of the iceberg. As the university gathers momentum, as chair, I expect to garner far greater international response. As the awareness of Nalanda and what is in the offing begins to sink in more, I expect we will have a very healthy kind of an endowment fund, which will not merely finance some of the important activities of Nalanda, but the best shining example of public funds being implemented with private cooperation and private initiative. It is the endeavor of the Endowments Committee to be able to harness this private initiative in consonance with government level.
When you work in an academic enterprise, you have to be totally dedicated to the academic enterprise. And you don't have to worry about rank and race and class and anything like that. University is a place for critical analysis. So a student can challenge a professor. Nobody has a monopoly of knowledge. Everybody needs to strive constantly. And just as the students have to excel at their examinations, the staff has, faculty has to be continuously improving themselves so that they are worthy of the students they are teaching. And I think that is the mark of an excellent place, is that nobody sort of stops improving themselves. You know, we all need constant improvement, and that should be the spirit of the university.
I consider there is one instrument or one armament which makes the quality of the university, that is the faculty, the teachers. I think faculty or teacher make the biggest condition for any university to excel in quality. Now, what does it mean by excellent teacher or excellent faculty? Teachers are basically the specialists in different areas, and they go to the extreme peak of that area. But what is expected of a good teacher or from a quality teacher is that when they reach the peak, from there they universalize it, they spread it on the sides, or they disseminate it further. And this results in finding out solutions to various type of problems or various type of issues. This means that their specialization acts as a mean to find the solutions. This ultimately results in grooming wonderful students.
We want to do what we can do best, what the world needs, and for which we have the resources and the feasibility to proceed. And I think, I've been Chancellor of this university since its inception, in another way, I hope I'm right in thinking that we have been doing that, that we have pursued more, we have to make it larger, and everything starts very small, even the 5th century in Nalanda itself started tiny. But we can make it bigger, we can make it larger, we can make it even more relevant to the world than it he already is. And that is, you know, I'm moving away as Chancellor of this university, but my commitment was not going to change. So then I first visited Nalanda U11, holding my grandfather's hand, and he gave completely bowled over by what I saw in Nalanda. That vision, that extraordinary history, still makes me thrilled. And I hope that we will succeed in making it into one of the great universities of the Gautama Buddha would have been proud.
So we hope that we have photographs taken. So this will be taken outside on the stairs. Nice. Yeah, I'll take from my phone. Okay. From your phone?
You can also send it to us.
Yeah, I'll send it to you. Yeah, that shape was nice, huh? Should we get them to? Okay. Isko bulaun kar? Okay, can a few of you just go on this side? Just on that side, on the outer edge. Just go here. Yeah, that looks better.
Huh?
Coming in the frame.
Everybody from the back, move out next to Patra.
She is not visible.
Rajkumar, is that you? No, move away.
She is not visible.
No.
Yes.
One second, no. Everyone.
Come this side. Yes.
You can come this side and you get.
Stand here.
Okay.
This okay, Pichai, Chandramurti.
Come down, come down. Now it's fine.
Keep standing.
One more. Just smile, just do some actions, come on.
Nice.
Sure. Done.
Okay.
In-house photo. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. This way.
Like this?
Oh, like this?
Okay, yeah.
आप फोटो आप इधर से लीजिएगा प्लीज इधर से लीजिएगा ओके
यस
Mitha, you direct your photographer first, yeah.
Okay.
Center of the universe.
Okay. Some formal. Achir?
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Diet?
She told us, right? That if you go, how awkward is it be and all that.
That's
we
totally
did. Yeah, just a whatever. You get the cake, that's what happens. You get just a plate of food.
Take the plate of
coffee. It is such a time. At least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 plus 6 is 12.
You are on record.
I'm not sure.